Hello everyone, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the VIP programme of Collect 2021, the International Art Fair for Contemporary Craft and Design. Supported by Loewe and Cox London, I'm delighted to be broadcasting live from the VIP programme from our new Crafts Council Gallery, which sadly isn't open to the public yet, but it soon will be. I'm surrounded by beautiful pieces of contemporary craft, and I'm also sitting on some amazing furniture that has been loaned by Cox London. So, what is the hottest contemporary craft to be investing in now? For this online version of our VIP programme, we're running a series of special VIP events called Collect Selects, each focusing on different materials that are used in contemporary craft. There'll be a Q&A at the end, and at the bottom of your screen, you should see a little Q&A box. So do start those and we'll try and answer as many questions as possible. So Collect Select number 2 is Textiles and New Materials, and in association with the Victoria and Albert Museum. Today's partner is the wonderful V&A, and I'm delighted to introduce to you Dr. Christine Checinska, Curator of African and African Diaspora Fashion at the Victoria and Albert Museum. And she's joined by the wonderful Anne Toomey, who's Head of Textiles at the Royal College of Art. So Christine, welcome both of you. Tell us what Collects means to you and to the V&A, and we are really excited to hear what you've selected today for us. Over to you.
Hi, thanks for that introduction and hello everyone. And for me, I'm very excited to take part in this event because, of course, Collect is the art fair for craft. And it always represents for me that moment where you can discover new emerging talent, whether it's across any discipline, really, and looking at different techniques. And for me, I'm very excited always to see the textile and fibre artists. So it's a rediscovery for me each time I come to Collect, and I fall in love with craft again when I come to Collect. And Anne, what does Collect mean for you?
Hi everybody, and thanks Christine. I think Collect is an incredibly important arena for creatives, craftspeople and artists of all types. It's incredibly rewarding when I see people who have come through the doors of the Royal College and have studied and are now very successfully practicing. And it's wonderful to see their progression, their development, and their wonderful work, but also to everybody else who hasn't come through the doorways, you know, where I teach. That's just a very local viewpoint on it. It's a very, very special arena, and I love the textile aspect and the way that the textiles are able to transcend so many different facets and levels and complexities. And that's the point of our conversation.
Absolutely. I always think that textiles is such a broad church, and that's why it's so exciting. And so Anne and I have selected 6 artist makers that we want to share with you. Each of them has a different aesthetic, different sensibility, and probably different concerns and motivations as well. But the things that are common to them are the things that really excite us. So they each have the ability to tell stories through their materials. And often those materials are either forgotten materials or discarded materials. And they also use forgotten techniques as well. That was the other thing that tied them together somehow for us. And then I also love the, what I would describe as craftiness of the pieces that we've selected, because they all of it is the artists, they somehow cause us to do a double take. You know, you look at them, you're not quite sure what the material is, you're not quite sure how they've been made, and that's part of the excitement. And it's great that we have some of the pieces in the Crafts Council galleries at the moment, so that we can do close-ups as we talk through each maker's work. So I hope you'll enjoy the selection that we've made and that you'll start to see the beauty of them, because I think that's the other thing. They all somehow are aesthetically so elegant, but very strong conceptually. So really exciting, collectible pieces. So Christian, could we have the first slide? And so we're going to start by looking at the work of Esna Sue. Now, Esna Sue is a very exciting artist. Her pieces kind of tie to her Turkish heritage, and she uses traditional techniques, but in this wonderfully contemporary way. So her work has a kind of timelessness about it, don't you think, Anne?
Absolutely. There's something about the ancient and the modern, and something about the known, but also about the unknown. The shapes themselves are timeless. I think they're wonderfully haunting pieces as well.
Absolutely. I wonder if we could have a close-up of this particular piece on the screen. And typically she uses these almost forgotten techniques like crochet, like knitting, to create these almost futuristic, I think they're sort of futuristic meets prehistoric, because they're these lovely kind of amorphous shapes. And you can see this wonderful close-up of the fibre that she's used, and the way she's used this knitting, this loose open stitch, to create the piece. What else strikes you about this work?
So I really love the way that she combines different techniques as well. So, you know, it might be crochet at one point, it might be knitting, it might be weaving, it might be combinations of them. And the way that she uses materials that are familiar, but the way that they're presented, again, it goes back to that thought of the double take. Yes. And there's a slightly unfamiliarness about it. They're incredibly organic. Mm. And I love the hollowness of it, and the sense of absence and what was there, and that somehow you can't quite make it out what it is, but it you know, it's organic, but it could be so many things. They're really very you know, they're exquisite things. And I think another thing about hers, which is common to some of the others as well, is this, what I call a material language. And she's developed this amazingly fluent material language, which she uses to convey very powerful messages.
Absolutely. I wonder, could we just go back to the slide of the whole piece, so that people have more of a sense of the overall shape that we've just describing, this kind of organic shape that she creates, and that lovely hollowness that Anne was speaking about. And I think as well, when we were looking at this earlier, as former makers ourselves, we want to know how they've been made, how she created these sort of hollow spaces. So elegant, and really, really clever use of traditional techniques and fibers to create this ultra modern collectible piece. Wonderful, wonderful work. I wonder, let's move on to Emma Witter. This is really exquisite, Emma Witter's work. And again, you have the idea of double take. When I first saw Emma Witter's work, I wasn't sure what the material was. And my first encounter with her work was a close-up of one of the sort of more organic floral textural pieces, and I had no idea that it was bone until I started to read more about her work. And that really excited me, the fact that she's using a material that once upon a time would have been part and parcel of everyday life. You know, we would all have been using bone utensils, for example, in our homes. We would have been surrounded by this material, but of course in modern life we're not. We're distanced from bone as a material. And that really strikes me as very interesting. How about you, Anne? What was your first reaction when you first saw Emma Witter's work?
Well, like you, I was intrigued as to what they were made out of. At first I thought, are they teeth? What's it made out of? And then looking at it closer, it's bone. And I think one of the things that I really, really love about her, as well as this dichotomy of the sort of the fragility of and strength, she transforms these into this incredible lightness and weightlessness in some of the pieces, and yet in others that they're really quite solid and quite round. Mm. And I think what she has as well is this sense of reveal, of storytelling about nature, and revealing previously unknown secrets of the natural world. I think the thing that really got me with her one was that sort of nature designs itself, and it's incredibly clever with its ability to organize and self-assemble. Emma reworks that story in a way that challenges the viewer to look twice Again, that same feeling, that double take. You know, we have to double take at it. And it's almost as though she's creating her own algorithms of construction in the way that she uses this material. I find it wonderful, really lovely.
Me too. I'm really drawn to Emma's work. And I actually popped on her website, and I just want to share, she on her website has an extract from a Seamus Heaney poem, and I felt that that there's real poetry in her hand. Again, as you say, it's fragile yet strong, and there's again a real elegance about this world that she creates out of bone. And I just want to read this poem because it for me just took me on this lovely kind of wandering journey around imagining her collecting these bones and preparing them and creating these intricate works. So the Seamus Heaney poem Bone Dreams on Emma's website. White bone found on the grazing, the rough porous language of touch and its yellowing ribbed impression in the grass. So again, this idea of a language, she's creating a language with this material, this bone that she's attracted to, and she draws us in, I think, with these exquisite pieces.
Yeah, they are really remarkable.
They really are. I wonder, shall we go to, are there more? I think we have two more slides of Emma's work. Some close-up slides. So the pieces that you're seeing at the moment, this is the piece that's in the gallery, but there are sort of still photographs of the same work. You can have a look at some detail. And then you can see how exquisite they are. And then, of course, you can start to see that they're bone. And I agree with you, Anne. It's just almost as though they formed themselves. And I get that with Esna Sue as well. You look at them and they're so organic. You feel as though they've just emerged and grown organically themselves, which is interesting because when I think of craft, I always think, oh, it shows the mark of the hand. And yet with both of these two artists, they've put their work together so well that they just look as though they've naturally formed that way.
Yes. Yes, they form themselves, self-assembled, grown in some way.
Yes.
From some kind of magical DNA. Yeah, fantastic.
Absolutely. Yes, they're almost like two alchemists, aren't they? Esna Sue and Emma Witter, the way that they use their materials and their techniques. But I think these are absolutely stunning. Absolutely stunning. Yes, I love the stillness about them. I think they're quite haunting, probably because it is bone. There's almost a spiritual aspect to them.
Yes, absolutely. And I think that that sense of ritual and that sense of spirituality is something that comes through in quite a few of the objects that we've selected for the afternoon's presentation. But the last two examples definitely really powerfully have that.
Yes, I find this work particularly moving, and I think it's the material, isn't it, and the fragility. So let's move on to our next artist, Sana. So this is also in the gallery, and this is fantastic. I think it's so exciting. And what excites me about this is the more that you look at this piece, the more you discover. And again, playing with this idea of double take, at first glance, it looks quite traditional. They just look like beads. It looks quite traditional. But then you really look, and if we can zoom in, I'm hoping that we can see the detail, but you realize that many of the beads are actually made out of recycled paper or found papers, and you can see the text on them. So again, the closer you get, the more the piece reveals.
Yeah, I love this artist's ability to work in this incredible detail, but also at scale. And they work in both of those ways. And I guess that goes back to the background as both with jewellery and with interiors designs. But they're mesmerising. And as you say, they do. They draw you in. And then you discover more and more and more. And they're wonderful.
And I even love in these images just seeing the stitching, the stitchwork, because of course every bead is applied by hand. And it's wonderful to see the little stitches in between and the way that everything is patched and pieced together. And also Sana is telling stories through his material, which again is really exciting to see.
Yeah, absolutely. So again, it's this material language, and the way of putting this together creates this story. And in this case, a storyteller of social and environmental issues. But it is for me with this work, it's the layering upon the layering of stories that are invested into these pieces, that they are really have tremendous depth.
You know? That's right. So it's as though they can be, as we were saying at the start, they can be appreciated on so many different levels. So aesthetically wonderful. And then you start to really look, and as you say, the more you look, the more you see, and absolutely, wrestling with political issues, the use of the recycled material, the storytelling, it's yeah, really powerful work. Mm. I love the fact that for Sanai, his idea to make newspaper beads almost came by accident. It's almost as though the method found him, rather than he found it. And on his website, he was sharing that when he was at art school in London, he stumbled across a piece of jewellery from the First World War that was made from beads, paper beads. And that's where that sparked his interest. And that was the start of his exploration of using recycled papers for beads. And he's known as the Bead King, I think, as well in Uganda, yeah, isn't he? But yeah, what wonderful work. And again, it has that kind of spiritual aspect, I think, as well, because of the process. Yeah. I know that he talks about the process, the sort of the bark cloth base, yeah, has to be beaten. And there's a real ritual around preparing the base of the cloth, and the rhythm of beating the bark cloth is rather like drumming. So again, the process is as important as, yeah, the final piece.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely one. Stunning work. It's so rich, isn't it? Absolutely stunning.
Very.
Mm. And perhaps should we go to Anna Ray?
Yeah.
And this is fantastic. Again, double take. So with Anna Ray, I think her signature is very much using materials that we're familiar with, but using them in really unfamiliar ways. So she transforms domestic equipment into using domestic equipment and tools as well. So things are stitched on a sewing machine. She uses pliers, she uses needles. So the domestic space is very much an influence on the final product that she makes, isn't it? Mm.
Yes, and her work is a melting pot of craft. It's sort of weaving, tapestry, embroidery. She's another storyteller, but one of ambiguity and slightly of the uncanny, and also of humour. I think there's a, yes, tremendous amount of humour to be found in her work. And again, the transformation of the familiar, which is wonderful. Her inventive way of using materials and turning the everyday into the extraordinary. Yeah,
I think you're right. I love the playfulness of her work. You know, I look at her work and I want to smile, and then I want to know more. But that playfulness, I think, is often missing. And again, I think it's really clever to be able to meld, to bring together something that's quite conceptual, but then also have the play about it. You know, it's almost carnival, isn't it, in a way, when you, yeah, look at the colours that she uses and the way that she uses almost things that are about the house to create, yeah, these fabulous pieces.
Yeah, so when you visit her website and you visit some of the articles and stories that have been written, she talks about this sense of not fitting in, which I find really fascinating. But I feel that she's created her own space as something other, and it's refreshingly different.
You know? Absolutely. It's quite hard to define. And I guess that comes from her sense of not really fitting in. She's creating works that you're not quite sure how, you can't pigeonhole them, and that's a wonderful thing. Yeah.
Ladies, can I just interject quickly here? Because I think what's interesting for the listeners and the viewers here is the value of these pieces, and to kind of put your knowledge and expertise around this, because I think some people may not understand why there's something a piece like this is £17,500, but there's obviously real reason why there is. So that I think that would be helpful from your perspectives and your points of view.
I mean, I think that Anna is collectible because of this. There's a kind of undecidability about where to place her and her artwork. And I think that that's what's exciting about her and the way that she's able to transform, but using everyday materials and everyday tools. I think that's what's exciting about her. That's what's generated the excitement. And I think as well, with Anna, I feel that every piece is quite different. Every piece is unique. And I think that that also makes it particularly special.
Mm. Yes, I would agree with that uniqueness, just looking at her work online and seeing the tremendous variety, yes, of what she's been able to do. So, you know, I get the sense that there wouldn't be many pieces like that, you know, if there was another, indeed, and that it is very, very unique. And I think a tremendous amount of work as well has gone into this. And you know, that sense of everyday should not affect the way that one thinks of it in any way. I think she's given materials completely new life and new value because of what she has done with them and how she's worked with them.
I think you're right. I think her work is materials driven, and that's why there is a sense that there's not a whole group of objects that look exactly like this. You know, each piece is unique because of her going to the material first and allowing the materials to speak to her and to create the piece.
And also they're very much materials of our time as well. Yes. And you know, we're looking at them in the now, and they've been made in the now, but how will one view this in 10, 20, 50, 100 years or more? And with some of the other pieces that she's used, they're very identifiable into a moment or a period of time. And I think that's really important with her work.
I think you're right. They kind of map history, don't they? Yeah. I think you're right. In 10 years' time, looking back, you'll almost be able to say so much more because of the materials that she's used. But obviously we have time for questions at the end, so if there are more questions, we're happy to share our thoughts on them towards the end. But that for us is why we chose Anna's work particularly, and what drew us to her work in the first place, this idea of the familiar and yet unfamiliar, the idea that there isn't, because she's materials driven, her practice changes, you know, that she doesn't have one look that she sticks to, because it's about finding those materials and maybe the common things across her practice. It's the use of domestic tools to create the pieces. And in some ways I was going to say that brings us to Julia Hall, which, I mean, I get really excited about Julia Hall's work, because I look at this, it's a painted canvas with over embroidered with these wonderful sort of threads hanging from it. And I immediately, I mean, being a textiles person, I think you probably feel the same, Anne, but it brings you right back in a really good way. It brings me right back to the subversive stitch and this idea of women's voices. And she's looking at patriarchy, she's critiquing patriarchy. So again, aesthetically stunning, but really political. And I think she's really kind of, she's not just revisiting that moment, she's updating it and saying new things. But because of our expertise and our knowledge, it absolutely ties it to that subversive stitch, the political and the personal, the domestic space, women's voices. I love the unfinished nature of them as well. So you get a sense of this ongoing story, this ongoing critique of patriarchy. I love these. How about you, Anne? What strikes you about these pieces?
Well, there is so much to applaud with Julia's work. I mean, it's hard to sort of pick on one thing. I mean, they are thought-provoking, ultimately contemporary. Her use of materials and methods, the way that she has used them and the choices that she's made within it really amplify messages that she wants to convey. I think that's just so amazingly clever. It's almost as though she's operating a, you know, kind of a dial, and she's turned it right up to the max with what she's doing. It's just fabulous. Multi-layered, complex, revealing the hidden, the invisible, again, the overlooked, the discarded. And again, once you start to explore the work, you're drawn into the many facets of the work and the different kind of points of view and messages and things just all start to come out from what is seemingly a very simple image of a you know, beautiful dress with some embroidery thread. It's so powerfully contained, so much stuff. So it's just fantastic. Really,
and each piece is so sumptuous. The paint, the it's oil paint with embroidery, but it's so detailed. I just find them really compelling. And we actually have a video let's have a look at it. This is the video that we're playing now. Yes. So you can see some close-up detail. It's the depth of the painting alone, and then to over-embroider and to have this political message as well.
Yes. I mean,
this is expertise, isn't it?
It really is. This is a sort of a master at work, I think. And when we were discussing this earlier, you spoke about this relationship between the high and the low art forms. And I think she plays that, she plays that kind of relationship and that ping pong and argument really, really well. Again, she's kind of master mixer on the mixing desk. She's just amazing.
Absolutely. And I love the fact that she draws on her own family tree and her own ancestry, and the idea that sewing was a technique that was passed from mother to daughter, you know, to sister and so on. So it's definitely women's work that she's exploring, but it speaks to so much more. You know, it's rooted in her personal story, but then it opens out into, you know, it's a female story, but then it's everyone's story because she's critiquing patriarchy. But she does it in such a stunning and artful way. Again, can be appreciated on many levels.
Yes, and I think, you know, she positions stitch into such a powerful tool for communication. So powerful, and we need more artists like Julia, really.
I think this is absolutely stunning, and the way that she's using embroidery, I think in such an innovative way, is fantastic. Yeah. And again, just the loose threads, for me, it's this idea of the ongoing unfinished story of the emergence of women and women's voices, really. Fantastic, elegant work, I think.
Very elegant. Yeah, wonderful. Very accomplished.
Wonderful. And then shall we move on to Annette Marie Townsend, another accomplished artist, and another double take, because when we were first looking through the artist makers, I almost looked beyond this and I thought, well, that's lovely. And I remember sort of thinking, gosh, those roots are stunning. And then I read that it was made out of wax and I could not believe it. How could she make this out of wax?
I can't imagine how those pieces are put together. I really can't imagine how she manages to do that. But they're fascinating on so many levels. Not just when you realise that they're handmade, handcrafted out of wax. How does she manage to do this? But then all the detailing and the kind of the recording, almost that sort of forensic recording of nature and species and type. And as I think she's called a scientific artist.
That's right. Yeah. I think she has a background in documenting and storing scientific specimens. And, you know, and that suddenly makes sense, the way that she forensically studies nature and then reproduces them in this almost hyperreal, surreal way using wax. It's just incredible.
It is, but it's not just about documenting and recording. She does so much more within the pieces. She's telling a story. She's telling us a story about, you know, her passion for the natural world and everything. But also, for me, I think they're intriguing pieces that really challenge our own sense of responsibility to our planet, you know. And in her role of sort of documenting this stuff, she's saying, hang on a moment, you know, take a look and have a good old think.
Yeah. Yes, and I think that makes her work even more relevant, doesn't it, for today?
Yeah.
You know, it's been interesting, a year of being in lockdown, and many of us are going out into gardens or public green spaces and re-evaluating and re-looking and noticing what's around us. And it's almost as though she's turned the volume up on nature. And it's just really timely, this work. Mm.
It is. And yet her work, you know, she's been working on this for many years. It's just at this moment in time, it just, as you say, seems to be so incredibly pertinent to our current position.
Absolutely. So I think she's the last of our artists. I think we just have the one slide for Annette. But what's exciting to me is that, yes, they're all very different, but I love this, the craftiness of them, the idea of the double take, the kind of the forensic looking and the way that they prompt us to scrutinise what's around us and reevaluate is really, really thrilling.
Mm. Absolutely. I think they all... you know, they all share this sense of presenting to us known materials, but doing it in an unfamiliar way. So that double take, as you say, all of them have done that. And in doing so, they successfully raise these thought-provoking questions and they inspire us actually to consider our actions within a world where so much needs to be put right. You know, so all of them, maybe it is something about the time that we're in, and the type of work that they have, but they all seem to have an incredible relevance right now. I think, you know, but not just for the now. I think for many years to come. You know, they in a way they mark a very important moment in time.
I think you're right, and that for me is what makes them so collectible. That's the timely. We're seeing experts at work. We're seeing storytellers at work, and we're seeing them marking the moment that we're in.
Yeah, and they all raise these questions surrounding sort of inequality, waste, destruction, displacement, all the things that are really coming to the fore now in all of our thinking, and that they're so apparent in the work of these artists that they're that voice is very loud. And it's very crucial at this point.
That's right. And as you were saying earlier, this idea of strength within fragility, or coming from fragility.
Yeah,
I think that comes through. You know, that they have powerful work, but there's a gentleness about them, of the slow process that it must take to create these works. I think that this gentleness, fragility, but strength through that feels very much a marker of where we are in this historical moment.
Yes, and in our earlier conversations we'd spoken about that slowness and that sense of time as well that's invested in these pieces, and all of these kind of intangible qualities. When you sort of cluster them together almost in a sort of cloud of response and thinking to these pieces, it is just so perfect for now. So perfect.
Absolutely. And I think that's a lovely point to maybe end on before we go into any questions or any thoughts that people might have.
Well, thank you, ladies. That was a lovely, just a lovely kind of movement through your thoughts, and what we were seeing there. I think it's so lovely to for you to be drawing on what you respond to emotionally, because I think the thing about contemporary craft is we do respond to it very emotionally. It's quite a visceral effect that it has on us. Yeah. And I think what we found doing this on as an online fair this year is actually textiles and these sorts of materials have actually translated quite well online, probably better than some of the more three-dimensional pieces, because they just have quite a pictorial feel to them. And it's interesting, I think, for us, because obviously you'll have seen the galleries that were representing these artists, and that's kind of why I picked a little back on value and how the gallerists are nurturing the careers of these artists and how they kind of carry them through and help them with that process of how they're furthering their practice and how it helps them develop and what have you. So I guess it was just a question around how have you seen textiles, because it's one of those areas of contemporary craft which I think is very accessible to a wider audience, because you don't need a kiln, you don't need a furnace, you don't need those sorts of things. You can literally pick up a needle and thread or whatever that might be. But it's that, you know, it's that tipping into the fine art market and giving it that value. And I think you've explained well about the skill behind it. But have you seen in your knowledge textiles move more into being accepted and being appreciated at this level?
I would say very definitely, if I just speak from my experience within the Royal College of Art and within the textiles program there, and seeing how work has developed within the program, and I'd like to give a little plug to two members of staff who are absolute stars in, and have responsibility for this, and that's Fiona Curran and Freddie Robbins, and between them they have really worked so hard, and with all of the team for sure, but they are the stars and champions of this, and have really pushed and developed this space, and we've seen increasing success and interest from, and global interest from all over the world, and people coming to study with us because there's the sense of freedom that textiles can be whatever you want it to be, and it can support the nonconformist. You don't have to do things in the right way, the proper way, whatever that is. We've seen how many people have how they mix things inventively and all sorts of things. So I, from my own very local position, I've seen a very steady, successful growth of practitioners in this area, and it's very welcome.
Yes, and I would, thanks, Anne. I would echo that as well. Before joining the V&A, over the years I have worked with various art schools with textile artists, and as you were speaking, I was remembering my time at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, and the fiber artists were producing absolutely unbelievable work. So I would echo everything that you said, Anne, because I feel that in my sort of forays, if you like, because teaching is not my, has never been my main thing, but working with those young artists, particularly at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, I mean, breathtaking work, strong work that is every bit as conceptual, as inspiring as other art forms. And I've always seen textiles as an art form anyway. I think I've come up through that school of thought. So it's absolutely on the rise, and there are people doing excellent work that needs to be recognised, I think.
Absolutely, and I think its value is becoming more accepted, and
yes,
sort of seeing textiles as materials to be used is becoming more understood. Mm. You know, it's had quite a hard kind of intro into the space, if you like, and I think sort of pioneers who've worked in these spaces in earlier years really need to be applauded, and we still are breaking that ground in a way. Mm. So, you know, in some respects, it's, I would say to people, get it while you can, because, you know, it's probably going to I would imagine, just increase as its audience broadens and more people are drawn into this area and are practicing in this way. Yes, it's going to become more widespread, but it's very, very encouraging to see.
Very good. On a slightly more practical level, and we often get asked this, when people do feel really drawn to something and they want to purchase it and they want to invest in it, I think some people feel quite nervous about the care of work afterwards. So in your vast knowledge of caring, particularly at the V&A and also with you Anne, in your experience, I think it's just people understanding to not be frightened of that, but you know, how people feel that they can, you know, look after their beautiful works of art once they've purchased them.
I mean, I think it is important to try to be in dialogue with the maker so that you understand the conditions, the best conditions for the piece. You know, as you were asking the question, my first thought was lighting. You know, it's really not a great idea to put your textile piece right next to your very gorgeous anglepoise lamp and point the bulb at it. You know, I'm making light of it, but for me, I would always ask the artist's advice on how to best care for the piece. You know, what are the best conditions for it? You know, keeping it in certain light. How might you eventually need to clean it? How would you go about doing that? Is there a conservationist that can be recommended that will be able to clean and repair as and when that needs to happen?
Absolutely, I would echo that totally. I would refer to the maker. It's your first port of call.
Yeah. Fabulous. You've seen me with all my notes. Haven't really, there they are all underneath. That was fabulous, thank you guys. For those of you who've been listening to this and those of you who are dipping in afterwards, because obviously we're recording this, we will be sending details of all the wonderful artists that you have been talking about today. And I just want to say a massive thank you to both Dr. Christine Checinska and Anne Toomey for their amazing knowledge and what their insights that they've shared with you today. I'm sure you've all really enjoyed it. Thank you both, and we wish you well, and we hope more of you come back to our other events that you can watch. So thank you and enjoy the rest of the fair. Bye-bye.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.